How many? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
One, two, three, four, five, here. All right. What did I get up to?
Hey. One question. Do the Cowboys suck or what?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of How Many, the only podcast on the internet that truly counts. I am one of your hosts, Jesse Jackson. Joining me is a full roundtable. We have Scott.
Hey.
We have Bob.
Hello.
We have Junior.
Hello.
And we have Gary.
What's going on?
So, as we're recording this, it is October 5th. The Cowboys are one offside kick away from being 0-4.
They're also bad pass interference away from being 2-2.
We're going around. We're talking Cowboys, buddy. We're 25% into the season. So, Gary, you're always a positive. You have your Cowboy tattoo.
Yes, we need to hear the Gary Bob, spin on why we should not trash the season.
Ask Bob and Junior how positive I was on Sunday. I was positive this team was terrible. That's what
so I was positive Jalen Smith does not need to be on the roster.
I was over at Chris's and
Trash.
He's like, it's okay, Dad. Like, I know we're down by like four scores, but it's really three because you know Cleveland is going to screw up sooner or later because they're Cleveland. Then at the end, he goes, yeah, I wasn't thinking about Odell. I didn't throw that into my mix. The best part of it, we went to the biscuit bar for breakfast beforehand, and that was good. All right, Gary, get us off the ledge. What are you thinking?
I can't get you off the ledge. I'm probably dragging you over with me. I mean, the football team's bad. If you subscribe to water finds its level, things always kind of even out over the course of a season. You can't rebound from this. You're probably going to end up giving maybe a franchise record number of points for the season just because of how bad you started. But the way this offense is capable of scoring, I mean, maybe you could give up 500 yards of offense and 30 points a game and still win 8 or 9 games. I don't know if they're capable of holding people to 30. That's kind of the problem. It looks like everybody's just kind of freelancing out there. Like, nobody expected Old Smith to be great, but he's been pretty good. All of the other guys that they brought in have been terrible. And DeMarcus Lawrence has been bad. And Jalen Smith is horrific. I can't believe they let him on the field over and over again. You know, they're missing two corners. They're missing two defensive tackles. They're having to start Tristan Hill, who, in air quotes, had a good camp.
Come on, baby. Yeah, he's Twistin' Hill now.
Yeah, because he likes to do the gator roll whenever he tackles somebody.
All right, Scott, your quick take.
I keep looking at this thinking, you know, and maybe this is every season. Where is the team we were promised? I know the defense wasn't great last year, but I sit here and look at it and go, how did it fall so far? Because I didn't feel Jalen Smith was that bad last year. You know, I was at the game on Sunday, and I'm sitting there watching this and said, this feels like the Keystone Cops. You can add jaunty piano music to this, and watching these guys miss tackle after tackle after tackle, you know, not be anywhere near the football on defense, the offense coughing the ball up. I hate to take it back to Dak, but, you know, I keep wanting to say, maybe it's a good thing we didn't pay him all that money.
All right, hold that thought. Junior, how about you? Quick thoughts?
Gary pretty much hit on all the major points. I'm having a hard time thinking of a worse Cowboys defense in the history of the franchise that I have personally seen. I know there's been bad defenses in the past, let's say, 30 years.
Yeah.
But in comparison to what we were promised,
right?
Has there been any that have failed expectations as poorly as this team has?
Statistically, right, this is one of the worst ever.
The Zimmer defenses, from a talent standpoint, I don't think were as hyped up as the one that we were supposed to have gotten this year.
They were supposed to be pretty good. I mean, anybody that thought that this defense was going to be stellar was fooling themselves. I was hoping for solid because this team has put all of its money and resources on the offensive side of the ball. So you're just hoping that a defense can go out and get, you know, force 3 or 4 punts and maybe get one turnover. If you can do that, this team wins games 35-28, 35-24.
Yeah.
But they can't even do that.
From a franchise record-setting standpoint, this team may end up giving up the most yards and points in franchise history. I mean, right now, they're bottom of the barrel in the league.
They're on track to obliterate the record.
The only saving grace is right now we're first in total yards and third in total points, but that's not going to get it done against teams that actually have legitimate defenses. The whole thing is just shocking to me. I cannot believe how
it shocks
terrible.
You. It shocks you.
It shocks you. It shocks you.
What Gary was saying about them not having enough of a training camp to adjust to the new system, I get that. But a lot of it to me is just effort and want.
It is.
And I'm just not seeing it.
Bob, any quick thoughts?
Well, I mean, the defense obviously is a huge disappointment, but the additional issue is you're also having an entire other unit, special teams, that's almost just as bad, if not worse at times. You've got two of the three units that are just absolutely dragging you to the bottom, and the coaching has not been what we expected either. That was one of the biggest reasons for optimism going into the season was, oh, we finally got rid of Garrett, and now we got McCarthy, and he's won a Super Bowl, and I mean, I love the aggressiveness. That part's been good. But other than that, man, they just seem like they're not prepared. They just seem like they're confused. They don't know what they're doing. And, man, they talked about it on the ticket this morning. Every team in the league didn't have training camp this year. Every team in the league, you know, had to deal with the quarantine and all that stuff. So that excuse is only going to go so far.
I'm not going to defend this defense because, like Junior said, they have a lack of effort. But if you're going to sit there and compare a team that changed defensive schemes, changed all of its coaches, changed six or seven of the primary defensive players. You're going to compare all of that to somebody who has the same scheme and the same players as last year? That's not the same thing. That's not apples and oranges.
Glad you brought this up, Bob, because that was going to be my next question. Which sucks worse, defense or special teams?
It depends on the game.
I think defense. I think the defense is having a bigger impact on the outcome of the game than the special teams. Special teams
is important.
Well, I
keep saying special teams lose yardage. How many yards do we lose on a kick? Off alone, and how many times does it have to keep happening before they change what they're doing back there? You know, I get tired of seeing balls run out of the end zone and he only makes it to the 18, you know, or to the one.
And I agree, defense is definitely having a bigger overall impact, but every game, not only the returns, but the blocked extra point and the Leon letting it, basic simple stuff, they're just effing it up.
Well, this just in this past game, right? If he had just kicked the ball to the end zone, maybe Beckham still has that round to go, but you think the odds are tougher.
There's just execution is bad. And even on offense, where they're really actually doing well for the most part, the interception at the end of the game was a poor execution by Cooper on the route. The lack of attention to detail is bad.
You know, and that's another thing, too, on that particular play. If you do that loafing thing in the second quarter and you're like, well, the ball wasn't supposed to come to me, blah, 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 whatever. You're still an idiot, but within the last couple of minutes of the game in a one-score game, if you don't run that route hard, you're an asshole and you don't need to be on the field.
Yeah, I mean, the idea, right, is everyone should be keyed up. Dak's going to have to find his best option. It may be a bad option, but it's the best bad plan we have right now.
And I mean,
you know?
The offense is not without problems. Zeke's got to quit fumbling the damn ball. That's killing them.
And you're right, Gary. We could be 2-2, right? And I know everyone's kind of hanging their hat on, well, we're in the East, so we could still win the division.
I was thinking that before the Eagles beat the 49ers last night. Now it makes me think
maybe. Thanks a lot, Mullins.
That's a decimated 49ers team.
That Mullins pick six, that was the worst pass I've ever seen.
But they're missing their quarterback, their running back, two wide receivers, their defensive end. If you made a list of all of their top players, they are literally missing the top six or seven players on their roster.
But we should have a higher goal than to win the East.
What you have to assume at this point, though, is say you win the East at 7-9, but in the last four or five games of the season, maybe you get a couple of guys back. Randy Gregory comes back in a few weeks. Maybe a few more guys are buying into the system. Maybe they've made a couple of personnel changes between now and then. Maybe between all of those things, the defense becomes mediocre.
Yeah.
With this offense, you get into the playoffs. Look, your defense is horrific, and you had a shot at Seattle.
Yeah.
You haven't been out any of these games. Even when you're down 20, you're in the game. I trust that if they could win the East, they have a chance to make noise.
And guess who's coming back home next week? Garrett himself.
Well, we lost the game, but you have to understand that this is a process. It's a process that we go through. We're in the process of going 6-10 this year. Okay, so you got to be patient. Processes take time.
The worst offense in the league coming to town to face the worst defense.
Yeah, that's another decimated team. So if the Cowboys cannot do to the Giants what the Eagles did to the 49ers, then we know that we have a serious, serious problem.
You're absolutely. I mean, if they're not embarrassed by what they did this week against Cleveland and then get a chance to take it out on a team like that that has nothing, they're in trouble.
If they can't hold the Giants under 30, at least, if not 20, that's red flag.
If they don't keep this team well under 30, then I'm just hoping for good draft picks.
Of course, I start getting worried that are we going to not take them serious? It would not shock me that this team once again disappoints us and loses to the Giants. And you go, right. Holy moly.
If they do that after getting embarrassed by the Browns, then the team doesn't have any heart and they deserve everything they get.
I think that losing begets losing. You know,
absolutely.
Winning will beget winning. I mean, losing begets losing. And, you know, you
snowballs.
Get, yeah, it snowballs like that.
But not the kind from clerks.
37. My girlfriend sucked 37 dicks
in a row.
No, not that snowball. The hope is, and, you know, I'll put on my Susie Sunshine, you know, being the optimist. You hope you throw a couple wins together. We start getting momentum. I agree with you. I am very impressed with this receiving core. I think they are badass. If we can just get back where we used to be, and then if the defense can do us anything, we'll see what happens.
I think some of it stems from the offensive line, too, when it comes to the mistakes we have made. Like, for example, the Dak fumble, that is all kind of pinned on the tackles not being able to keep Garrett out of the backfield.
Part of that's coaching. Oh, yeah. Because
part of it's coaching.
They left Steele one-on-one with Myles Garrett.
That's an undrafted rookie against what might be the best defensive end in the game.
It's good that you bring that up, Gary, because I did look at the last 5 years of drafts to look at who we drafted for offensive line. I'm going to read you these names. Chaz Green, Lawrence Gibson,
who
is a late seventh round pick. Yeah. Connor Williams,
okay.
Yeah. Connor McGovern, okay. And then this past year, Tyler Badich, the center. Those are the only five linemen we have drafted in the last five drafts.
They're thinking, right? We drafted so many offensive linemen for so many years. We now need to spend it in other places.
I think Gary's got the right philosophy. You draft linemen on both offense and defense all the time because numbers, you need the numbers, and yes. It's attrition. That's the position most prone to injury.
But I mean, when we get to the point where we're having to start undrafted players, to me, that's a direct reflection of how poorly we have drafted offensive linemen.
You can say that, but that's the same guys that drafted those guys in the last 5 years are the same guys that drafted Travis Frederick, Zach Martin. They brought in Leo Collins. He wasn't drafted. He would have been a first-round draft pick. They also drafted all pro players. Like, sure. When they drafted Travis Frederick, everybody said, what in the heck are you doing? He doesn't belong there. And then he goes out as a rookie, and he's all pro.
They hit on him early in the 2010s, and then it's feels to me like they said, okay, we're done with this part of the offense. We're going to ignore this for the next 5 years. This is why we're in the situation we're in. And injuries, players retire, and then we're stuck with the Terrence Steeles and the Brandon Knights of the world.
Gary, what's the story with McGovern? You've got undrafted guys playing ahead of him, but he's not hurt, right? He's not injured.
No, he was hurt last year going into the season, so he ended up on IR for the season. But every scouting report that I read and every time I heard any of the analysts talk about him pre-draft and even after the draft, everybody said the same thing. Probably the most pro-ready guard that you're going to get outside of the first round in the draft. They were surprised that he slid to the third, blah, blah, blah. Everything great, right? And then he gets here and he's injured and you're like, well, we don't really need him. So that's okay. Sit on IR for a year. No big deal. But then this year rolls around and Travis Frederick is now retired. And you got Joe Looney and you got Biotish are being the ones mentioned when they talk about the center and the guard spots. And I never even hear McGovern's name come up. McGovern was supposed to be guard and center. And he's not being even mentioned in either one of those battles. So why? I have no idea. I haven't heard a single thing about him. Nobody has said injured. Nobody has said anything.
So we'll go around the table. Not lost faith in the coaching staff.
Not yet.
Not completely, but man, they need to turn that S around.
I'm probably about 80% in on the offensive staff. I feel pretty good about what they're doing. There are still times that I wish they would do a few things to help a poor offensive line. The special teams, the same thing that we had problems with last year, we're having problems with now. Why the hell a guy brings the ball out of the end zone when you know you're going to get it on the 25? Put your heels on the goal line. If you got to go back to catch it, leave it alone.
Yeah, I just understand that at all.
And Bones is supposed to be a great special teams coach, so I don't know what's going on there. Obviously with the defensive staff, they can't get these guys to play hard. It's one thing if you can't get them to pick up the system,
Like, I don't know if any of you ever watched this, but I watched a thing one time where Belichick and Jimmy Johnson were on the boat fishing together, and they were just talking and drinking beer. And they were talking about some of their philosophies about picking and finding players. I don't remember which one of them said it, but one of them said, I remember when you told me, if I ever draft another stupid player, hit me in the head with a hammer.
My number one thing was, hit me in the head with a hammer the next time I take a dumb guy.
Yeah. You taught me that well.
Because
you can't fix that.
90% of your mistakes are with guys that you can't reason with.
And I'm afraid that we've got a bunch of really stupid players that single high safety thing that they demanded that we play on every snap on defense last year is the only thing these guys can do without confusing themselves and leaving guys running wide open. And if that's the case, then it's not just a talent problem, but you got to replace everybody because they're too dumb to run NFL defense.
So speaking of the coaching staff, there's already starting to be some rumors about, surprise, I'm back. Is there any chance of Wade maybe returning?
No. Surprise, I'm here.
No.
Yeah, defensive coordinator.
As a defensive coordinator, I'd take
it. Yeah, absolutely. I would do that.
He's a fantastic defensive coordinator, but he's going to run a 3-4, so you're going to go through some growing pains.
You don't make a change this in season, though, do you?
To the coaching staff or to the philosophy?
Yeah, coaching staff and philosophy.
I don't know that I would change philosophy in the middle of the season, but if I don't see improvement, at least from an effort standpoint, I'd damn sure change the coaching staff.
Do you think Jerry would be on board bringing back somebody he fired previously?
I don't think he would. I think that would be the big stopping point right there for him.
I don't know that he and Wade necessarily had a falling out.
I don't think they did either.
If it had been somebody he was cross with, like Bill Callahan's probably not coming back. But Wade's such a cream puff, and he's not coming back.
He's going to resurrect Camp Cupcake.
And I'm sure Jerry remembers how good some of those defenses were with Wade.
You know, would 840 bits be so great if he comes back?
Surprise, I'm here.
Wade, can you step in my office for just a minute, please?
Hey, Jerry, how's it going?
Well, it's not going well.
Yeah, well, you want some pralines or peanut brittle? I just made a Stuckey's run. I'm loaded up for training camp.
No, and you shouldn't want any of that crap either. I'd expect these athletes to take you seriously when you're built like the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
That's funny, Jerry.
I don't see Jerry making any coaching changes staff-wise. I think he will give this team a year and give them the offseason to try and clear out who they think is not giving effort, who doesn't fit with their system. He'll give the team a mulligan this year. But if this happens next year, then I could see defensive coordinators going, offensive coordinators going. I don't think he'd fire McCarthy.
I agree with you to a point, but I think if you see 3 or 4 more games of the defense like we've seen with the record-setting numbers, they're not going to ride that out all season.
Yeah, the reason that I would disagree is because we're sitting here talking about would they make a change in season. If you don't do it in season this season, and you don't do it in the offseason because you give them a mulligan, then you might not do it in the middle of next season, which means that you're 2 years in before you actually make a change. Jerry knows he doesn't have that much time left.
Yeah. I had said they'd be 10-6. I'm going down. I think they'll be 8-8.
I think that's optimistic.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, I do too.
Well, we haven't seen them play the NFC East yet.
All right. Anyone have a better record than that, or the rest of you think they're going to be 7-9?
If everything breaks right and they get some of their injured players back, like Gary said, if the defense actually starts to care and show some effort, I could see 8-8, 9-7, because Gary's right, we haven't played any division games yet. So in theory, we have a chance to win, 3 or 4 more games out of that, but I can't see them getting any better than 9 wins.
Any other final thoughts before we wrap it up?
Well, no funeral.
Oh, gosh. Yeah.
Bob, where can people reach you?
On Twitter and Instagram at LukewarmTallBoy.
Very nice. Scott?
What is it? GS Matula?
I think
on the Instagram. Yeah.
Mr. Gary?
I'm going to change my name to Xavier Woods Sucks 2 on Twitter. But for now, it's just travel_cowboy.
Was Phelan Jalen already taken?
And I am at Jesse Jackson DFW. Hey, Junior, if they want to reach us, tell them not only how they can reach you, but how they can reach the podcast via Twitter and email.
All right. So on Twitter, at How Many Podcasts, you can also reach me directly, Metzkin_Junior on Twitter. You can email the podcast, howmanypodcasts@gmail.com. You can send us a message on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. Just search for How Many Podcasts. You can find us on Facebook. We have a Facebook page. You can message us there. Lots of different ways to reach us.
And I did want to throw out a little shout out. We have some new listeners.
Right.
I've gotten a little feedback from people that they've recently found the show and they're enjoying the discussion. So if you are a new listener, thank you very much. We appreciate you joining us. And to our old friends, we are so glad you're sticking with us.
All three of them.
Yes.
Hi, Lyle.
Yeah. But for now, we're going to keep hope alive and still glad we don't have Jason Garrett. And we will talk to you soon.
Dallas, Dallas Cowboys, we are the Cowboys.